Well, thank you, Jeff, and Mr. Secretary General, everyone here, let me address you as living beings on this planet. We're all in this mess together. Whatever our rank, whatever our position, whichever country we live in, we're all in this together. I've always loved the forest. I think I fell in love with the forest when I was a child, when I met Tarzan of the Apes and fell in love with him. And dreamed to go to Africa, live with animals and write books about them. And I ended up in the Gombe National Park. I spent many, many years in that beautiful forest. When I arrived in 1960, you could go all the way along the shore of Lake Tanganyika, and it was forest stretching as far as the eye could see. Climb up the hills, look to the east, trees, chimpanzee habitat, a few villages. By the mid-80s, when I had an opportunity to fly over the whole area in a small plane, the little Gombe National Park, 30 square miles, was like a living jewel, surrounded by completely bare hills, more people living there than the land could possibly support, too poor to buy food from elsewhere, struggling to survive. And that is the story of what's happened to so many forests around the world. I think everybody in this room knows an awful lot of what I'm going to say, because that's why you're here. But just, you know, let me emphasize the benefits from the forest. And yes, we all know what they are. We hear about the clean air, but I don't know how many people have actually lived and breathed it for months and years on end, as I have. And we know about the clean water. We know about the medicinal plants that are there. And we know too that these trees and the forest soils sequester CO2. When Nicholas Stern announced his report, I was there in Paris, and I remember him saying, ladies and gentlemen, the most efficient and cheapest way of slowing down global warming is to protect and restore our tropical forests. And of course we all know that the tropical forests are disappearing. They're still disappearing, as the Secretary General said. And there are many threats to the forest, but if we have to pick two or three, it's the timber industry, it's cutting down the trees for cropland, farmland, cattle ranches, and so forth, and the need to grow ever more food. Ever more food, because there are ever more people. And it strikes me that if we look across the whole planet at reasons for deforestation, they fall into three main groups. The first is poverty. Because if you're living in poverty, you're going to cut down the last tree, even if you know you're creating a desert, because you've got to grow something to feed your family, or sell the tree for charcoal or something like that. Necessity drives you to destroy your environment if you live in poverty. And the second reason how I perceive the forests are being destroyed are governments handing out or selling large areas of forest as concessions for the timber industry, mining concessions, and the petroleum industry. And this is sometimes to line the government's coffers, and it sometimes lines the pockets of corrupt ministers. We all know that. And that isn't just in the developing world either. And the third reason that drives deforestation is big corporations coming in to make money, as much money as they can, as quickly as possible. Cutting down the trees to make cropland. They don't live there, they don't love the land, so it doesn't matter if chemicals are sprayed onto the land. It doesn't matter to them that gradually the land is losing its fertility. And it doesn't matter to them, apparently, that various peasant farmers are driven away from their land and their livelihood, and the age-old cultures of producing food in the different seasons are being lost. So what are the solutions? From my own experience, the easiest one to try to solve is alleviation of poverty. And after I'd flown over those bare hills, I realized there's no way we could try and save the forest or the chimpanzees while people were struggling to survive. And so that led to our Dakari program, which I'll come back to later in the afternoon. But it's basically helping people to improve their lives through microcredit, helping them to protect the watersheds, helping them to reforest the slopes, to reclaim overused farmland so that it once again becomes productive, and better health, better hygiene, microcredit programs, and family planning. Addressing the problem of the governments, well, this is what one of the reasons that this conference is gathered together, this COP. And it's because a government is going to want some money, the money it would have received from selling a forest concession. And that's where these carbon credits or schemes like the Green Fund can be so powerful. And I think we're all waiting very eagerly to find out the cost of carbon so that some of these projects can actually start working a bit better. The Red Plus program, as the Secretary General said, is very good for helping the poor people, but it's not really helping the government. And then there is the fact that people in many developing countries are becoming much more aware, much more concerned about their own future. And when the president of Uganda was going to give away a piece of protected forest for a plantation of sugarcane for biofuel, the people in Kampala went out on the street and protested, and that piece of forest was saved. And of course, there are always interest groups lobbying against plans of this sort. And the corporations, is there any solution here? Yes, of course there is. And again, consumers are becoming better informed. When they can, many of them are trying to buy products that have been more ethically produced, that haven't destroyed the forests or other environments. And partly driven by their customers and their customer needs, corporations are beginning to investigate ways in which they can more ethically source the products which they're selling. And although some of this we know has been greenwashing, nevertheless, there are those corporate leaders who truly do care, who truly want to help protect the forests and the environments for the sake of the future of the planet and their own children. Are there problems ahead? There are huge problems. Let's make no mistake about it. The problems are enormous. How are the corporations going to find sufficient land to grow sufficient ethically produced food? They're going to have partners on the ground, like NGOs or local pressure groups, to ensure that those products have been ethically produced. And will there be enough land to grow them if our human populations continue to grow, as they are growing? So if we're going to tackle all of these problems in the future, first of all, educate our young people in the rural areas and in the developed countries and the developing countries so that they understand better. Let's listen to them and let's empower them to take action for their own future. And these kind of movements are spreading around the world. And secondly, we must take out of the closet discussions about human population growth. It's politically insensitive to talk about it, but we have to talk about it if we care about the future. So the last thing I would say then is that each and every one of us must take responsibility in our own lives, make our own right ethical choices in the way that we live, because we are all in this together, and each and every one of us makes a difference each and every day.